Good morning. And welcome and greetings to everyone as we gather on this lovely Sunday to worship God. And especially if you're here as a visitor, we welcome you very warmly. If you're here as a family or friends for confirmation, we are so delighted that you're here with us in worship for a very action-packed service today. We're going to have many things going on. This is the sixth Sunday in the season of Easter and the celebration of the resurrection of our Lord, and certainly a very special Sunday in the life of Salem Church and in the lives of our three confirmands this day. Owen Luggenbuhl and Brianna Runheim and Blake Adams. They've been meeting weekly throughout this whole year with me, learning enough stuff about our Christian faith and tradition to make our heads full, and they've been showing great personal faith and inquiring spiritual growth as we've been discussing so many different things. Their statements of faith are a great inspiration as I read them, reflected in their own words. And also on display are posters for their confirmation projects that are here in the back on the right. These are the confirmation projects. Brianna and Blake were doing free bikes for kids, and Owen with Blankets for Kids Madison. These are great projects, and we're so thankful for their witness and their work. We're also very proud of their growth and nurture over these years, and honored as they make their profession of faith today to be members of Salem Church. There's also going to be a reception lovingly prepared by the Women's Guild in their honor after worship today. We also today want to express our thanks for the Barry Robinson Chorus. We've had to be very adaptable over these past 2 years in so many different ways, but we're deeply appreciative. This will be the last Sunday that they will be singing for this season, and we're very thankful and blessed by your music to help guide and lead us today. Please note also on your calendars that next Sunday is Memorial Day weekend, and that will be the last Sunday worship at 10:15. On June the 5th, we begin our 9 a.m. summer hours for worship. Friends, in our prayer concerns this morning, we do want to keep Cindy Remus's brother Warner in our prayers and his fiance Ann, as Warner has just had a bone marrow biopsy, and he's going to be receiving injections soon. We pray for strength for the treatments and hope for a movement toward health for Warner. We're also thankful for the skill of the surgeons and doctors and nurses in caring for our brother, Johan, in South Africa, who this week had triple bypass surgery. He's been surrounded by great care and many prayers, and he came through the surgery and appears to be gaining strength each day this week. And friends, finally, we want to lift up in our prayers and love Elizabeth Pankinen. I was informed this morning Elizabeth is hospitalized with a lung infection and has been diagnosed with COVID. And so we pray that she can feel our loving prayers and respond well to treatments to ward off this time of illness. Now, are there any other special joys or concerns or announcements to share at this time? Well, hearing none, then, we have our introit from the BRC.
Will I open wide, though he rebuke?
In our worship today, parts of our service are going to be led by our confirmands, and so friends, please, as you're able, stand and we'll be led in our call to worship by Blake Adams.
God, be gracious to us and bless us. God, make your face to shine upon us,
that your ways may be known on earth, and your saving power among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let all the nations rejoice and shout in triumph, for you judge the peoples with justice and guide the nations of the earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has given its increase. May you, our God, bless us. God, grant us your blessing, that all the ends of the earth may revere you.
Please join me in our prayer of confession in unison. Most merciful God, you pour out on your people every perfect gift. We confess that you are more willing to give than to receive.
You have given us your law and commanded us to obey. We have taken our own path of disobedience. You have given us your Son and instructed us to hear him. We listen to other voices and shut his mouth. You have given us your Holy Spirit to enable us to do your work. We have chosen to try to do your will in our own strength. O loving God, we pray that you will be patient with us. May you remain slow to chide and swift to bless, until at last we learn to trust your perfect will for the sake of Jesus our Savior.
Amen. Let us open our hearts to God in a few moments of silent prayer. Sisters and brothers in Christ, know this. There is nothing in heaven or on earth, not pride or error or broken trust, not rage or long petty habit, nothing which can separate us from the Lord, our God and Jesus Christ.
Therefore, we rejoice. God's grace abounds. We are renewed over and again by the claim of love. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Friends, for our morning prayer, our prayer reflects in its words the reading from Acts of the Apostles that we're going to be hearing later in the service. For eyes to see and ears to hear. Let us be in prayer and conclude with our Lord's Prayer. O God of dreams and Lord of visions, we pray for eyes to see and for ears to hear, for hearts and minds that will respond to all that you reveal to us. Come, said the man who spoke through the night. Come to Macedonia and help us. And his plea echoes others offered down through the centuries. Come, they chorus. Help, they implore. In places of famine and the desert, they cry. Bring to our nations the waters of life. In places of pain and brokenness, they cry. Bring to our nations leaves for healing from the tree of life. In places of conflict and betrayal, they cry, bring to this world the peace that was given by Jesus himself. And of course, today, as we reflect upon those who have brought the peace of Christ into our lives, who have shown us the ways of integrity, of faith and hope, we will endeavor, O God, to instill justice and peace, freedom, healing, and love to the next generation who will lead your church. In this oft-broken world, we pray that the commitments of faith and new ideas, coupled with faithfulness and renewed ideals, will lead them to lead us. God, in these days when the murders of the innocents continue, so vivid and so often on our TV screens and internet, that it shatters the innocence that should shield us from despair, the innocence that sometimes seems lost too early in life, that should protect us from the volume of hate that threatens to overwhelm our ability to work for peace. We pray, O God, that you would remind us that you have already conquered the world, as represented by the symbol of Christ that came from hatred, despair, and death, but shows us life and love, the cross of Christ. And so, O God, we reach out beyond ourselves in prayer. We pray for the people of the city of Buffalo, even as the people of the city of Buffalo pray for the rest of our society, that we might become aware of evils that lurk in the shadows of our culture. We pray for the people of the Irvine Taiwanese Presbyterian Church, even as they pray for the rest of our world, to know that there are so few or no safe havens from those who would choose to do ideological violence, nationalistic harm. We pray for the people of Ukraine, even as they pray for the hapless and the helpless who have attacked them and continue to destroy, even as they are but pawns in the games of the power mad of other nations. Pray, O God, for ourselves, that we might never become numb to the pains and to the yearnings of so many in this world. Our holy and gracious God, help us to remember that your reign is to be known on earth as in your holy presence. For in your presence we rejoice with all and we share sadness with all. We support with prayers and care and love toward all, and especially today toward Warner and Johann and Elizabeth. Hear now the prayers we lift in a few moments of silence, and yet whom we mention in the words of our souls. Our God, give to us all, and especially to those who profess their faith in you this day, our confirmands in whom we place so much hope and love, give to us ambitious faith, an ambition to see visions and to dream dreams, with eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts and minds to understand. For those we seek to help today and tomorrow may indeed be the very ones that you choose to anoint to reveal pathways of your peace that we are yet to walk. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who walks our pathways and teaches us to pray in one voice, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, all. As you can see, we have Sarah joining us. And for those of you that were at church last Sunday, you know that we celebrated the Sunday school teachers and everything that they did this past year. It was great. But today, Lisa and I, on behalf of Salem, would like to recognize Sarah Punt for everything she had done and also is doing for Salem. You know, some of you might not know, but Sarah is juggling two roles. She's the Director of Youth Ministry, and also the Christian Education Director. So she's juggling both and doing a wonderful job. Her work in both roles is invaluable, and the gratitude we feel here at Salem really can't be expressed in words, and we don't take enough opportunities to say thank you. Today we want to say thank you. We want to say thank you for thinking outside the box. You know, seriously, thinking about ways to grow these ministries and thinking creatively about ways to love, teach, and mentor our members and youth. I also want to say thank you for your willingness to listen. Listen very good. Trying to understand our worlds and our perspectives. Because of this, we share openly with you. And it's a tremendous gift to communicate our fears, our sorrows, our questions, and our concerns about our lives without feeling judged or belittled. Sarah, you're truly an angel. And it's wonderful to have you here at Salem. And we're so thankful and blessed to have you in our lives. And I'll turn it over to Lisa. Sarah, to talk about.
One of us will talk next. To show our appreciation, there is a gift card for you, but there's also two books in there. And I selected the books with John's help. So you hopefully don't have them. He did a little looking around to see. But they're books that are gifts for you to nurture your faith. And one is a devotional book that's been quite popular this year. And I suspect that with both books, you will actually, not only will it nurture your faith, but it will also be something that we're all going to benefit from, because I'm sure she'll use it in her ministry here. So one's the devotional book, and then the other book was the last book that Sarah Held Evans wrote before she passed, or Rachel Held Sarah. We've got Sarah on the brain today. Rachel Held Evans wrote before her unfortunate and untimely passing. So hopefully that will be something that feeds you. And I want to say to you, I have the opportunity as the Associate Conference Minister for Faith Formation and Justice Ministries for the conference to work with youth ministry and Christian ed people across our conference in Wisconsin. We have 214 churches. I also work with our national setting and with my colleagues across the denomination to support and resource faith formation and youth ministry people. And we are incredibly blessed here. I work with people who have master's degrees in this stuff, and Sarah outshines all of them. She is often someone, when she's doing something, I use her ministry here as an example to help support others. And so we are really, really, truly blessed to have her as our faith formation director and our youth ministry director. So thank you.
So on behalf of Salem.
Good morning. I didn't know I was reading today until I saw my name in the bulletin, so I'm winging it. I'm a former special ed teacher, and we're used to doing that. So today's reading is from the Acts of the Apostles, Acts 16, verses 9 through 15. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the woman who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us.
I feel very uncool. And Kathy, to make apologies, I did send out the reading for this week, The Joys of the Internet. Friends, this is a very, very wonderful and special time in the life of any church, and particularly here at Salem Church, as we now meet and greet and receive the profession of faith of our confirmands. At this time, I would like to ask if Blake and Owen and Brianna would come forward and would ask their families to come with them or their parents to come with them. There is a script that you all have, because it's very much a participatory endeavor. So Brianna and Owen, Blake, your families. Also, each of the confirmands have two council sponsors. If the council sponsors are here, and we already have George coming forward as a parent, but also Carrie Westfall is the Vice President of the Council. I'd like to invite her also to come forward if she is available. Okay, so we'd like for the confirmands to face the congregation with parents behind them. Scripture talks about a great crowd of witnesses. Well, we get the crowd up here. Friends, Blake Adams, Owen Lugan-Buell, and Brianna Runheim are presented for the reaffirming of the baptismal covenant into which they were baptized. They now desire to profess publicly their faith and to assume greater responsibility in the life of the church and God's mission in the world. Friends in Christ, we are all received into the church through the sacrament of baptism. These confirmands have found nurture and support in the midst of the family of Christ at Salem United Church of Christ. Through prayer and study, they have been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm their baptism and to claim in our presence their covenantal relationship with Christ and with the members of this church. They are here for service to Jesus Christ, using the gifts which the Holy Spirit bestows. Brianna, Owen, and Blake, we rejoice that you now desire to declare your faith and to share with us in our common ministry. In baptism, you were joined to Christ and welcomed into the fellowship of Christ's church. In the community of the people of God, you have learned of God's purpose for you and for all creation. You have been nurtured at the table of our Lord and called to witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so hear these words, direct from Jesus, from Holy Scripture. I am the vine, you are the branches. Anyone who abides in me and I in that person is the one who bears much fruit. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you will, it shall be done for you. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. So these are the questions that, in the United Church of Christ, that I would ask you now to affirm your baptism. Do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? Do you renounce the powers of evil and desire the freedom of new life in Christ?
I do.
Do you profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciple, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and the word of Jesus Christ as best you are able?
I promise with the help of God.
Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world?
I promise with the help of God.
I would ask the congregation now if you would join us in the affirmation of faith. Let us unite with the church in all times and places in confessing our faith in the triune God. Do you believe in God?
I believe in God.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit.
I would ask our three confirmands to join with me in this prayer. O God, my God, known to me in Jesus Christ, I give myself to you as your own, to love and serve you faithfully all the days of my life. Amen. With the congregation, let's first have a few moments of silent prayer. Now let us all pray together. Almighty God, who in baptism received these your servants into the church, forgave their sins, and promised them eternal life, Increase in them the gifts of your Holy Spirit. Grant love for others, joy in serving you, peace in disagreement, patience in suffering, kindness toward all people, goodness in evil times, faithfulness in temptation, gentleness in the face of opposition, self-control in all things, thereby strengthen them for their ministry in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. I would now, for each of the confirmants, would ask them if you could please kneel, Blake. And I would ask that parents and sponsors, if you could place hands on our confirmant. We rejoice, O merciful God, with Blake and Owen and Brianna, in the gift of the Holy Spirit and in the Spirit's power to awaken us to new truth and to inspire us to venture into the fullness of life. We give you thanks that they have been moved to affirm their baptism. Help them to live not for themselves, but for Christ and those whom Christ loves. Keep them steady and abounding in hope, never giving up, pressing toward the goal of life with you in Jesus Christ. Amen. By your baptism, you are made one with us in the body of Christ, the Church. Today, we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith, which has brought you to this time and place. We celebrate your presence in the household of faith. Okay, please stand. Okay. Go around the circle. Owen. Owen Joseph Luganbuhl, the God of mercies multiply grace and peace in you, enable you to truly and faithfully keep your vows, defend you in every time of danger, preserve you to the end, and finally bring you to rest with all the saints in glory everlasting. Amen. Brianna? Brianna Nicole Runheim, the God of mercies multiply grace and peace in you, enable you truly and faithfully to keep your vows, defend you in every time of danger, preserve you to the end, and finally bring you to rest with all the saints in glory everlasting. Amen. I think I missed that prayer for you, didn't I? We're going to make you kneel again. I'm still learning the ropes of the UCC. All right, hands back on him. Blake Daniel Adams, the God of mercies multiply grace and peace in you, enable you truly and faithfully to keep your vows, defend you in every time of danger, preserve you to the end, and finally bring you to rest with all the saints in glory everlasting. Amen. Amen. You're really done. I would ask now our confirmands this question about participation. Do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people, sharing regularly in the worship of God and enlisting in the work of this congregation as it serves this community and the world?
I promise.
And for the congregation, let us, the members of Salem United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ. We promise you our continuing friendship and prayers as we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses of our risen Savior. And those who are the council representatives, please join me. In the name of Jesus Christ, and on behalf of Salem United Church of Christ, we extend to you the hand of Christian love. It's great, it's almost choreographed here. Friends, let's have a prayer. Oh God, we praise you for calling us to faith gathering us into the church, the body of Christ. We thank you for your people gathered in this congregation and rejoice that you have increased our community of faith. Together may we live in the Spirit, building one another up in love, sharing in the life and worship of the church, and serving the world for the sake of Jesus Christ. Let all God's people say, Amen. Amen. And now we have a presentation of some gifts and certificates of membership.
I also had the distinct pleasure to work with each of these people, and they are truly a gift. And if you ever get discouraged about how things are going in the world, I can tell you that with these three, whatever they touch in the future will be bright. I hope that the three of you see the community standing around you and loving you and supporting you, and you take that with you wherever you go. No matter where life takes you, Salem will be your first church home, and you're always welcome back at any time. And I hope you take what you've learned from us out into the world and make it a better place. I have letters for each of you from the conference minister, Franz Riegert, welcoming you. They're personalized. And the youth ministry team has put together framed prints for you. Each print has your name on it, your date of confirmation, and a Bible verse that either you chose or your parents chose for you. So keep that someplace handy and refer to it often. And now Judy Scoopian, as a representative from the Women's Guild, also has a card for each of you. And the Women's Guild has also supplied, as Tom mentioned earlier, a very nice reception for you after. So congratulations.
Then there is a benediction, but you still have to stick around for a sermon. But friends, go to your pews in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
These words from the Gospel of John are some of the last instructions from Jesus to his disciples, just before his arrest, trial, and crucifixion. John chapter 14, verses 23 through 29. Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you love me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now that I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. This is the gospel of the Lord."
Thank you, Brianna, and thank you to all of our confirmands for a wonderful year. It's been a great privilege for me to be able to share with them and to try to remember what it was like to be a teenager. It's a long time ago. But as I was thinking back on that, I remember the times in which I was growing up, when I was your age, there just didn't seem to be a lot of peace in our country and in the world, especially that peace of which Jesus speaks that Brianna read for us. In those days, our country was racked by the civil rights struggle, especially in many places in the American South where I lived. I remember thinking that if there was no more conflict between the races, well, then we would be at peace. And yet, even with all the changes and the laws and increasing interactions and opportunities and equality in many arenas, we still didn't feel at peace with our differences. Better, perhaps, but still not at peace. And now, in our own times, It seems that racial enmities and atrocities prompted by hatred seem to be daily on the front page. Even in Buffalo, where my first church was in Buffalo area, I remember driving up and down Jefferson Avenue for the site of the Tops Friendly Market, where the massacre occurred just a week or so ago. We also, in those days, had the Vietnam War going on. And what a time of challenge and turmoil in our nation. If only we weren't engaged in that conflict anymore, then we would be at peace. But no, we got away from that conflict, but we still were not at peace. No deep sense of peace. And internationally, there was a Cold War going on between the Soviet Union, aka Russia, and the West, the United States and NATO, constant threat, not only a military conflict, but overshadowed by the ever-present prospect and threat of nuclear weapons. In those days, whatever exhaustive list of conflicts we might have written, whether between nations, between races and cultures, economic levels, between individuals, the ruining of the world's ecosystem, the polarizing of political parties, conflicts between families and within families, if we could have resolved them all, would we have still felt at peace? All of those situations sound remarkably familiar, don't they? Not much has changed. And yet Jesus still wants us to be at peace. Jesus wants us to have peace. He said so. Each time we share communion, we repeat Jesus' words to each other. Peace be with you and also with you. How often do we really feel peace-filled? Yeah, I thought so. So I want us to consider what peace actually means, a deep spiritual peace. Is it just the absence of conflict, or is peace something much more? I'm leaning toward peace meaning something much, much more. I remember a story about a man who was at an international airport many years ago, before the era of the iWatch and smartphones. He was worried about missing his plane flight. He'd misplaced his watch, he couldn't see a clock, and so he asked a stranger about the time. The stranger set down his two large suitcases and he looked at his wristwatch. Sure, it's exactly 5:09. The outside temperature is 73 degrees and it's going to rain tonight. In London, the sky is clear, the temperature is 38 degrees Celsius. The barometer is 29.14 and falling. In Singapore, the sun is shining brightly. There will be a full moon in Des Moines tonight. Plus, your watch tells you all that? Oh, yes, yes, and much, much more. You see, I invented this watch. There's no other timepiece in the world like it. I want to buy that watch. I'll give you $5,000 right now. No, it's not for sale. $10,000 for that watch. No, I can't sell it. You see, I plan to give it to my son for his 21st birthday. I made this watch for him. Listen, I will give you $20,000 right here. I have the cash on me. $20,000? Well, okay, it's yours. The man gleefully paid the owner. He took the watch, he snapped it on his wrist, and he said, thanks, as he turned to leave. Wait, wait, said the stranger. With a smile, he handed the two suitcases over and said, don't forget the batteries. Well, it's before the era of the smartphone. Well, friends, this sermon is about the watch and the batteries. It's about the mechanism in our lives that sets things aright but also the power that makes that happen for us. This is a sermon about peace and blessing. So first, peace. What is peace? When we say peace be with you, what we're really saying should be, what I say to you, I commit myself to fulfill for you. Peace I leave with you. I commit myself to fulfill that peace for you. And why do we say that? Well, because Jesus said it, and Jesus did it. And the risen Christ said it, and the risen Christ did it. And the Spirit of Christ says this to us, and the Spirit of Christ does this as well. Does what? Offers us peace, grants us peace when we accept the offer. Now, peace, as we learned in an earlier series, is our translation of the Hebrew word shalom, and it means so much more than just the absence of conflicts. Peace, shalom, means wholeness and completeness. It means fullness and fulfillment. It means hopes that lead to actions that lead to restorations. It means to fill in the great dents and gouges in our souls. It means to sense the perfection of love that is God's presence, and having sensed God's presence, to incorporate that perfect love into our lives and self. You see, shalom is the good stuff of what life is to be made of. Shalom is the watch that tells us that all we want, all we need to know is God's love. And thus it sets our hearts at peace. Peace I leave with you, Jesus said. Peace I give you, not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let your hearts not be troubled. Don't let them be afraid. Okay, so if shalom, if peace is the watch word, what are the batteries? What's the source of power to make such an improbable condition as peace and wholeness? Well, the batteries is Berakha. There, I said it. Now you know. Berakha. What a relief. You can all be happy and contented. Berakha is the answer. And you're all saying, huh? All right, you don't speak Hebrew, so let me give you an English translation. Blessing. We know the word blessing. It's how we translate Berakha. Blessing, we think. Well, that's when God's in a good mood and gives you blessings. Good things in life, health, great job. Kids who do what you want. Parents who do what you want. Freedom from diseases other people seem to get. Does that mean they're not blessed? Again, our understanding of the translation into English is not adequate. There's a scholar whose name was Johannes Peterson, who wrote a classic book entitled Israel, about the concepts of the Hebrews upon which the Old Testament is based and upon which Jesus understood and framed his own ministry and self-understanding. It's not so important you remember Johannes Peterson's name, but do remember this about his teaching. He taught that blessing is not God doling out good things to some and not to others. If it was, how could Jesus preach, "Blessed are the poor in spirit," or "those who are persecuted for his sake," or "those who mourn"? Wouldn't that be a cruel message to those who are lowly and abused and grieving, if that's what he said was blessing? But if blessing refers to the grace of God, the pure selfless care and involvement of God in our hurts and hopes and needs and concerns, when we're empowered and made strong, knowing a God who cares, knowing the care of a God who chooses to share even life's hardness with us, it's then that we are truly, truly blessed. Like a God who allows the incarnation of his own divine love become crucified rather than strike back in hateful wrath. When they crucified Jesus, they thought they had won by killing him. But they found that Jesus had won it all by loving them. And so blessing, berakah in Hebrew, grace of God offered to allow a human being wholeness and meaning even when the world only offers crucifixion. That is the battery. That is the source of the power. An acceptance of that grace, that berakah, that blessing, is the watchword of being at peace. Just this past weekend, I heard a speech that touched me in kind of an unusual way. It was a speech that spoke of the kind of grace that sometimes means granting that grace, that blessing, that peace to ourselves, even if we don't feel exactly perfect or even if we don't feel okay. And the words, the speech, came from Dr. Taylor Swift. Yes, that Taylor Swift, the mega award-winning singer-songwriter, who was given an honorary doctorate of fine arts from New York University. How many of you heard part or all of her commencement address? No. Well, let me tell you about it. She gave the commencement address at NYU, and in it, she shared her experiential words of wisdom, but actually, she called them life hacks. Young people know what that means. Among them, Dr. Taylor Swift said some really important things. For one, she acknowledged that having started her stellar singing career at age 15, there were a lot of teenage and young adult life that she simply missed out on. She knows that. And university experience was among them. For another, she said that everyone, including herself, has some things that she called cringe. Cringe. Everyone. Looking back, she said, we all have cringe. Now, I personally have no idea what she's talking about by cringe. But imagine, if you will, a teenage boy in the early 1970s with wavy blonde hair parted in the middle, flowing beneath his shoulders, mustache, maybe a goatee, wearing wide lapel magenta triacetate shirt, a tight-fitting sweater vest, floor-length blue velour bell bottoms with 2-inch cuffs, white belt, multicolored suede 2-inch platform shoes. If such a person ever existed, that would most surely qualify as cringe. But such a person would eventually stop listening to disco, develop a different sense of style, look back on that era of non-fashion, the what were we thinking decade, and laugh, and then go on to MIT and become an astrophysicist. As Dr. Swift said, we all have cringe. So don't despair. And finally, she said that some of her greatest successes came out of her mistakes. She said, we learn from our mistakes, and they allow us to move beyond feelings of what we are not, to discover the possibilities and the appreciation of what we are and what we can still become. Now, last Sunday in our worship, in our sermon, we learned from Acts of the Apostles that even the apostles can make mistakes. The Apostle Peter, who was one of the top two leaders of Jesus' new church, well, he thought all Christians first had to convert to be Jewish in order to be Christian. After all, Jesus was Jewish, the Messiah that was expected was supposed to be Jewish. But then God gave Peter this dream with a sheet coming down with all kinds of animals on it and said, eat them. Peter said, oh, no, no, no. And God said, what I make clean and acceptable is now clean and acceptable. Peter learned from his mistaken assumption. And, well, that's a big part of why we're here in our church. Likewise, the Apostle Paul, the other early church leader, who was also a Pharisee, well, he assumed that only men could be church leaders. And then, yes, another dream vision. God told Paul to go meet an astounding woman named Lydia. Well, see, Paul had other plans. He wanted to go here, and then he wanted to go there, and then he wanted to go there. But God said, nope, go to Philippi in Macedonia. And once there, Paul went out on the Sabbath looking for a synagogue, and he didn't find any because there probably weren't any. So he goes to a river, a natural place to seek tranquility and prayer. And there at the river is Lydia, a very successful woman. She's the manager of her own household, which was very rare in those days. She was the seller of purple, which only the very elite could wear or afford. And so Lydia was someone who had all of the physical and social things that we might consider blessings. And yet she needs something. She knows she needs something. She lacks something. We're told that Lydia had been searching for God and interested in this religion of the Jewish people. When Paul meets Lydia, he shatters social customs by sitting down and talking to her and to other women. That was just not done. Because Paul now realizes this is why God sent him here, to correct his mistaken assumption and to bring the peace of Christ to a land with many gods but so little peace of heart. And finally, I love the way that Lydia, who's this very strong woman, takes charge of Paul's ministry. Essentially, she says, well, Paul, if you find me to be a faithful person, then you will accept my hospitality, and you will use my household as your home base for spreading the gospel of this Jesus Christ. Go on, Paul. Dare to say no to that. As they say, the rest is history. Paul's preaching and ministry spreads throughout the entire Gentile world to the ends of the earth, largely because peace and blessing, the watch and the batteries, came into Lydia's life. And here we are today. So the Apostle Peter, the Apostle Paul, and Dr. Taylor Swift, they all have it right. Peace doesn't come from avoiding life or ignoring or escaping life's tough moments, because they will find you. But peace comes in learning from them, finding the blessing in them, accepting peace as a gift. Peace isn't something anyone can give you. It's not something you can manufacture, and it's not something you can buy, because peace is already always there, ready for you to accept because of the blessing that God's love and presence provide. The watch and the batteries The only difference is you don't have to carry the batteries, because the Holy Spirit's with you everywhere. It goes wherever it will, Scripture says. It surrounds us even when we feel most alone. It surprises us with its power in the middle of our most powerless times. So confirmands, Brianna, Owen, Blake, and adults and church leaders, and all of us, take God's offer at face value. Accept God's blessing, and peace be with you. Peace is with you. Peace is within you. And through God's blessing, peace is you. To your friends, your families, to the people in need of a friend, to a world that really, really, really needs peace. Friends, peace be with you. Amen. Let us have the wisdom to receive this gift. Then let us have the courage to share this gift as well. The peace of Christ be with us now and always. Amen.